I'm interrupting.
Yeah. Nisan Bulavanaka, talo falava, and welcome to TP Plus. I'm Alice Tagata. Over the next half hour, I'll be chatting to our panel about our topic of the day, trades versus professions. In our community, do we place too much on university degrees? Should we focus more on the trades? Well, joining me to have their say, a former unionist and now business director for a communications company, Jerome Mika. Qualified scaffolder and youth worker, Matalena O’Mara. Founder and CEO of civil engineering experts, the Trao Group, Saia Latu.
Oh, he's here.
Oh, wow, wow, wow.
And of course, our very own John Bulu.
Thank you so much. I didn't get, as many titles as they...
Yeah, we just thought we'd just keep it simple.
Cool. Yeah, simple. Good, good.
Well, kia ora, everybody. Welcome to the show. Before we start, though, throughout the show, we'll be playing a game of Who Am I? We'll give you clues so you and our panellists can try and guess who our mystery Pacific person is. Here's our first clue. I was a top gun at my sport, even though I did not play on Sundays.
Oh.
So there's a movie clue there. He's also an athlete as well, so...
Top Gun Sunday.
Yes, keep your thoughts to yourself.
Okay.
We'll find out very soon. And we'll have more clues later on and we'll see if our panellists can guess who it is. But first, let's get into our discussion. What do we think, trades versus professionals? What are your thoughts, Jerome?
Yeah, for me, I don't think it's either. I think it's all of the above. I do think that trades have been the poor cousins. You know, especially coming from first generation, you know, my parents come over and there was always the perception that you had to go to university to be successful. And we've seen so many strong tradespeople kind of go through, earn as they learn, but also they don't have that debt. And so I'm sort of the, not one or the other, I think it's all of the above. I think both of them are very important and they should always be options that we consider.
For me personally, I think each of them complement each other because I have a trade and I have a profession. So I actually quit my trade as a scaffolder and went and retrained as a social worker. And throughout the time that I made that transition, I talked about a lot about my scaffolding career when I was training in tertiary education because of the demographic that I came from. So I was a female in a male-dominated domain, the gender inequality, the constructions of society and how we are. Mm-hmm. I think it actually comes down to the individual and what makes them happy.
Yeah, so you've been in both worlds, hey, which we'll definitely come back to. Saia, are you trades all the way? What do you think?
Oh, I agree with Buffy. I think that there's no... wrong. So, but I feel that there needs to be a lot more emphasis on trade, only because, you know, as PR, we always, whether you're a doctor, you're a lawyer, you know, you're an accountant, you know, and a lot of emphasis is not on, how about an electrician, you know, how about a plumber?
Yeah.
I don't know about any of you, but have you had a plumber lately come and do some work? Mm. Have you seen the receipt? You know, these are sort of... I'm building a house at the moment, and I'm like, going, I should have done that when I was in school. If somebody told me about that, I should have been a plumber. Mm. So I think we need to, you know, as the generation that's coming up now, they need to understand that that's a very good job to actually... They actually pay really good money.
Yeah.
As well,
so. We'll come back to the money bit because for me, like growing up, trades was never an option for me.
Yeah,
it was
right.
Always for you and I.
Absolutely.
Really.
It's that pressure, family. You
Absolutely.
Know, coming from the Pacific, they're like, you know, you either become a lawyer, accountant, or a supermodel. Oh, sorry. That's just that's just my family.
Is that a trade?
Yeah. So I decided to be a broadcaster. But yeah, it's that upbringing of, you know, success is these roles, but plumbing and engineer, oh, no, it's...
The beauty of trade is it's something that you can pass down.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you cannot pass down being a lawyer, you cannot pass down being a doctor,
yeah.
But you can pass down building skills, being able to be a plumber, like tricks of the trade with being an electrician, painter, scaffolding. It all teaches you something different, and realistically, a lot of Pacific Island peoples that I've encountered and that I've met, they work really well with their hands.
What about the pressure that you get from families who are traditionally always going to say, go to university, get a degree, I want you to be a doctor, a lawyer? We've all had that from our families. Can you guys relate to that kind of story?
Yeah, it's always been in terms of success, and people have always talked about, you know, going to school, back then getting your school C, your bursary, and then going to university. Anything other than that journey is a failure. And I think we've come to a the realisation that there's actually things like, you know, line mechanics, plumbers, you know, there are also earn as you learn, because a lot of kids will try and fulfil those expectations and promises that they make to their parents. They come out with no qualifications and they have a big debt. But with some people that have gone through the trades, they have been able to sort of earn it as they learn.
Yeah, yeah. Well,
but also formal education may open more doors. Do you guys agree with that? Or?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, as we said before, it goes hand in hand. If you go and study for 4 years, let's say a doctor, maybe 5-6 years and 100 grand, so you come off, you're already in debt starting off, you know? So, but when is your training, as you're saying with your cousin, he's already getting paid to train.
Right.
And I think we need to really think about that, you know? We're starting off our, you know, our youth or, you know, our the future, looking at, you know, less debt. You want to be, you know, debt-free,
yeah.
You know? And that's one of the key that I love about, you know, the trades.
Yeah. Well, just quickly, are we saying there's more money in trades?
Hang on.
A lot of the discussion was around money, making...
Well, it
the facts are that is if you do, you know, go to university, you will have the first year free through the government initiative, but then you have to go through, you know, incurring debt. But with trades, you earn as you learn, you know, so
right. There
is a very different dynamic to it, but that doesn't mean that at the end you won't be getting the same, you know, the same sort of wages or salary. So it's but it is both options. It's not just one exclusively. And we've only been back in the past been given those one option.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll come back to this discussion. Very good discussion. JP, what did everyone say out there on the street?
Some good discussion here, ladies and gents. Here's what people had to say out in the field. What do you think is better, trades or picking up a profession?
I prefer trades. I'm more proficient than trade, but that would be because it's just not for me.
From my parents' perspective, study at university, if I had to go back 10 years, pick up a trade.
I think they both equally have an importance in our community and society, and so without professionals, obviously we would get a lot of different stuff done. Without people who are in trades, we won't have houses to live in or water to come out of our pipes.
Welcome back to TP Plus. Today our panel's talking about trades versus professional careers. But first, here's the second clue for our Who Am I mystery person. Here we go. I'm immortalised in bronze.
Whoa.
Thinking statues, maybe, yes. Oh, Matalena's really confident there. She knows who it is. Well, we'll reveal who our mystery person is at the end of the show. Right
Very
now,
much.
Let's get back into it. Let's carry on where we were before. Saia, I mean, there seems to be, and you brought it up, in trades, a shorter amount of time spent on study. That's got to be a huge benefit for people in trades.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you could go from 3 months in training straight into a job, you know, and you could, and you're not in debt. You know, some of these training, they're actually for free. You know, we have the likes of MPTT, Multi-Pacific Training, who are giving these courses for free. So if you're out there looking to do some free training, you should be looking at MPTT for training. It's free. And you're straight off earning, as you were saying, without having to go into debt. And it's a big, big plus, I feel, for some of our PI, because we're struggling. You know, it's just a... having a look at your options, I suppose. If you've got money, then, go and study.
Yeah, and the reality is university is very expensive. So are we just saying no to university study? Is that completely out of the picture now?
I think when it comes to, like, tertiary education in general, you need to look at the overall picture. It's not just a journey that you take on yourself, it's a journey that you go on, that your whole family go on. Like, the only reason why I was able to survive going through my own degree is because my best friend and my sister would have me over for dinner. They would send me home with food parcels because I went from I went from full-time employment and a very high-paid wage to a student allowance.
Wow.
And so it's, I think, like, I enjoyed my time studying and I'm grateful that I did it, and I now think that each of my areas complement each other. But I think anyone looking at wanting to go into higher education needs to look at the bigger picture. Yes, we may have your first year free, but what about your financial support, your accommodation supplement, you know? Where are you going to study? How much is it going to cost you to live in that city? And then if you get a student allowance, that's not enough to live on, so you have to go and get a part-time job. And so you have to study full-time, you have to work part-time, which you're expected to work full-time. And it is a huge sacrifice, but it is achievable. But it comes down to the individual and their commitment, I think.
Yeah. And for some professions, you need a university degree. There's no, I mean, doctors need one, lawyers need one.
If I may, Madam Speaker, thank you for the opportunity.
Yes, you may.
Yes.
On to you.
Back to me now. I must say, you know, when it comes to education, it's not a one-size-fits-all kind of thing. And, you know, people might be better at doing trades than, you know, going into university. I remember when I was at Harvard. No, I'm dreaming. take my time. I look back now when I was studying. I remember there was this particular student. Her family forced her to go to study law, but her heart was in broadcasting. So I think it was the first or second year she left the law school to come and pursue you know, broadcasting. So sometimes it's what you want to do. You know, don't be forced to do something that your family wants. At the end of the day,
well, what are you telling your family?
I guess it's look at the options, and all four boys are very different, and they have very different sort of. Characters, flaws, and you know, sort of strengths and weaknesses. But I mean, going back to you know, what John had said, he talked about the whole thing around kind of kids trying to find their options, and also remembering that a lot of our youth, some of them, if they don't sort of get their qualifications, they go straight into factories. I mean, I worked in the union movement for 15 years, and we see they just give up and forget their potential. But actually, when you go into some jobs, like I was working with different companies like Fonterra and Amcor and some of the others, you should try and look at a trade then where you can actually be an extrusion operator, be a line mechanic, you know, be a fitter and turner, because you can still progress even though you might not have made where you want to be. And there's also the discussion around NEETs, you know, not in education, employment or training. Right. Those are some of the kids, like some of the initiatives of Mana and Mahi that the government started. Things like the Got a Trade, Got It Made. All these initiatives are just options for us to consider.
So just to add on to that, so if you take just an example, Fulton Hogan or Fletcher's, okay, so if you come out and start working with them, whether you're your hammer hand, you have options to actually pay you to go and study while you're working for them. Mm. So those, just to add on to what you were saying, those are the options where you get paid to go and trade by these big companies. So, just, you know.
But in trades, is it physically draining? Does it take a physical toll? Is it a dangerous job as well? Because those are the questions I'm thinking that would be like a con for me in terms of trades. What do you think, Matalena?
I'm going to speak specifically to scaffolding because that's the trade that I came from. Yes, it's a dangerous job. And I used to, every day I went to work and somebody asked me to do something that I thought was dangerous, I would politely say to them, and are you going to explain to my family what happened at me?
Right.
And what happened at work today, you know? And it's like, and I'd always ask myself when I was asked to do something, how much is my life worth? Is it worth the $150 the company's going to make by me putting up that scaffold?
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of cowboys out there because people don't understand the importance of health and safety.
Yeah.
And health and safety has taken a huge... there's been a huge shift from when I was there. Like, workplace bullying didn't even exist when I was a scaffolder.
Wow.
And it's there now. And, like, it is... When I was scaffolding, it was physically draining, but when I transitioned from tools into office, it was physically and mentally draining. So, yeah, I think it's all of them. But then in saying that, I think tertiary education is mentally draining.
Oh, okay, in a different way.
It's just complete mental draining.
Is it, yeah, the physical toll, do you think that's a turn-off for some people who are looking to what they're going to do in their careers?
I don't think so. It's because, I mean, you touch on, you know, we as PR, we like to touch, smell and feel. That's, you know, what we want.
Tactile,
so
yeah.
it's and you just create a lot of our PR don't know that health and safety is actually a job. Mm. They have $100K to become a health and safety officer. Mm. And then a lot of the students that I talk to, they have never heard about it. You know, like he mentioned it, and it was a very good point, because health and safety, what? That's huge. You know, there's so many jobs created in the trades that a lot of us need to really, you know, look into. And a lot of the people I work with, they love what they do because they're constantly, you know, whether they're working at a bridge one day, they're like, you know, working in a tunnel, or they love what they do and they want to learn more. And then if they want to, you know, go to tertiary from there and become a designer or architect or, you know, engineer, of course they can.
Yeah. So, awesome. Hold those thoughts, guys. We'll come back to that. JP, what did everyone think out there?
Me, Taki Mata, yes, tradies versus professionals. This was a good topic. Let's have a look.
For me, I've spent years at university. my husband worked in trades. I think they're both equal.
In my previous job, I was a lecturer, so in IT and stuff like that. So jumping from that to hospitality meant I could do my passion.
What about your children? What would you like for them?
Jeez, just to be happy, respectful people, and look, whatever they decide to do in their future or with their lives, then I support them 100%.
Everybody, welcome back to TP Plus. Today we're talking about the pathways to prosperity, trades versus professional careers. But first, here's the last clue to identify our Who Am I mystery person. Ooh. It's your last chance, guys. Some people call me Sir. Ooh, that should have given it away.
You know
now.
What? I think I don't know the answer. Yeah.
Nice, don't worry about that. We'll reveal all soon, but right now let's get back to our panel. Well, we're talking about, there's a statement that nothing beats having a university degree. Do you guys agree with that, Jerome?
I think based on what we've discussed, I don't think it's the only, I don't think it's the silver bullet for all our youth. I think it's one of many options for a growing Pacific population and young people. I mean, we've got the youngest population with the median age of 23, so we can't say that just one, all those kids are going to go to university. We have to have the options for them to consider so they can kind of get and reach their potential, and whatever success looks like for them, that's what should be for that individual.
I agree with exactly what Jerome said. It's very close-minded to say that one statement is a cover blanket, and you're basically restricting a young person's opportunity to pursue something that will intrinsically make them happy.
Mm. In terms of our Pacific communities, the reality is a large group of our people are working in non-skilled work. How do we transfer that into the trades or professions? How do we get them moving into other types of work?
We have to do a lot more work in the trade industry to advertise these sort of jobs available and also look at that you can actually still can go to university and then say, okay, if you start here and then in the next 2 years you'll be here, in 3 years, but we don't actually do that. You know, and I think that's one of the biggest issues.
Yeah.
You know, it's just like go become a plumber. But it can actually be more than, you know, you can actually own your own business in the plumbing. But we don't give that sort of, you know, it's like, can you possibly own your own business? We don't, in the trade, we don't actually don't, a lot of influences in, you know?
Yeah, and I agree with Sarah. I mean, I know even in terms of some of the, there was a survey done for a lot of the teachers, and I think the careers officers at secondary schools have a big role to play as well.
Absolutely.
That they need to also identify from the year 9 to 13, if the kid is not sort of working in terms of English, maths, and, you know, look at other options that they can kind of be able to build. But the careers office, through some of the surveys, were saying are quite influential too. So it's not only family members, but also some of the career paths, and we've just got to be encouraging our kids to take those careers.
Right. Well, what about automation? You know, so many things are done with computers now, dare I say it, robots. Is that going to affect the trades in some way? Or is, in that respect, is professions the right pathway to take? What do you guys think?
Oh, absolutely, but that's years to come. But still, the trade, you still need that. I mean, if it, the civil infrastructure, I call that trade as well. Right. To actually, you still need these sort of people to actually put the lines in.
So, yeah, a robot
can't
do it. Well, maybe,
replace.
I don't know.
You can't replace. You still,
that kind of work.
What about a TV presenter?
Or something like along those lines.
Don't worry, guys.
Very hard to replace these jobs.
Welcome to the...
Well, that could be our future, right?
Yeah.
Like,
that's
a reality.
No, but that's that's a good point to make because, you know, I work with the unions that had printers and the printers earned a lot of money, but automation has sort of wiped out all the Mac operators and some of the... So, yeah, eventually there's going to be automation that will sort of take positions, but like the plumbers and the builders, you know,
so
all
what
of
do
those
we do?
Are so important. Because even the digital space and the create, I mean, a lot of people are moving into the IT, so... but I still think it is about... considering all the options because, yeah, like you asked in terms of questions, there is that fear that you could go through an apprenticeship, learn it, and then that ticket becomes sort of, you know, extinct just because of automation.
Yeah, replaced by a program or something.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Was there the same fear for you, Matalena?
No, because buildings are always going to need to be built and, you know, you need to get up to those buildings. So you can use heavy machinery to get up there, but nothing will beat a scaffold when you're building in construction because it covers a whole bunch of bases. You can have multiple people working, it's a health and safety thing, you can cover it to protect it from the public. machinery will never replace scaffolding.
There's only plumbing at Mars, okay? You need plumbing, okay?
Oh, I'm happy to hear that.
Yeah, but you brought up a really good point about IT jobs. Should we be going into tech jobs? I mean, that's everybody's saying that's the future, right? What do you guys think?
I mean, you know, like with taxis and Uber and, you know, all the disruptors, there's going to be the fear of a lot of things with automation. And there's even some discussions around the Uber Air with the Zephyr Airways. And, you know, and there's all these things that are coming in and they're happening quite fast. I mean, social media has only been around for a certain amount of time, but there will be things that come and go just because of automation and they're moving quite quickly. So I guess for us, we just got to do our day-to-day grind and see where the options are. If they do go, you know, we have to, like we've always done in our Pacific, you know, our parents come to New Zealand, they've adapted. And I think as Pacific people, we're very resilient through the generations and we will adapt as things go.
Awesome advice. Well, it's time to wrap up. It's also now time to reveal our Who Am I mystery guest. We're going to give our panel 5 seconds to write their answers on the cards in front of them. Go for it.
I think you all know
who it is now. But before we reveal our panel's answers here, JP, did anyone get it right on the street?
Lassie, yes, this was fun. Here's what people had to say.
Bronze, silver. Sunday.
I can see him, but
Michael Jones?
Michael Jones.
So Michael Jones, Iceman, and all that kind of stuff.
Mahalo nui loa, ladies and gentlemen. Let's come back to our guests. Can you name your mystery person? Starting with you, Saia.
Oh, you're excited, Saia.
Okay.
I love it.
Okay.
Oh,
nice. Wow. Okay, yep, I can't say. Yes, last one.
He's a proud man from Mota'ai and his chief name is Savai.
Wow. Oh. Wow. Wow. Wow.
He's right.
The correct person is Sir Lauli Savai, Michael Jones. Woo! Congratulations.
Extra points under here, Jerome.
But in this show, everyone wins.
Oh, yeah. What do they win, JP?
Well, Michael Jones is waiting for you outside!
Yeah. That's awesome. Well done, guys. Well, that's the end of this week's panel discussion. I hope we've inspired you here either way. Thank you so much to all of our guests for joining us. Also, join us next week when Tangata Pasifika returns for another season of community news, views and entertainment. It's been a pleasure bringing you TP Plus, the panel discussion. I hope you've enjoyed watching the summer series as much as we've enjoyed making it for you. Until next time, kia manoia, ka kite. Thank you, everyone. Oh, no more sweating.
Thank you.
Thank you.